Hello and welcome. My name is Mark Huber. Delighted to have you here. I live in beautiful Vancouver, British Columbia with my lovely wife and Lucy, our gorgeous ragdoll cat. I'm a successful certified financial planner, investments and insurance broker with over 28 years of experience in the financial services industry, author of numerous blog posts, reports, videos, much like this one, over the years, but I'm best known for the 30 Dirty Little Secrets Your Bank Doesn't Want You to Know About Your Mortgage Insurance, How to Get Rid of Your Mortgage and Create Wealth the UnCanadian Way, and How to Get Rid of Your Credit Card Debt Fast. All of these resources and more can be accessed through my premier planning site at markhuber.ca. Huber spelled H-U-B-E-R. You know, life is risky and challenging enough, but getting insurance doesn't have to be. My role is to quickly and effectively guide you to the solution that makes sense for you and your family. Because everything in life carries risk, and what we must do is come to terms with that and either determine whether we will assume it, avoid it, or transfer it. And this is where insurance products come in, because especially with life insurance, for example, it creates an instant estate for you. And what does that mean? Well, your premiums are being paid, so that in the event that you suddenly leave this planet and go fly with the angels, your loved ones will end up having the cash necessary, which is provided by the life insurance company, so that your goals and dreams for them and for yourself can be realized and properly funded from the life insurance proceeds. In fact, I like to say that with insurance, you pay pennies to get dollars. For example, can you imagine how long it would take to save up $500,000? But if you have life insurance contract for $500,000 and you pay the premiums, your beneficiaries will be getting a $500,000 check from the life insurance company, generally within 10 days or so. In a nutshell, that's what insurance does, and you know, we all get that. And trust me though, your widowed spouse does not care what kind of life insurance you bought after you die, whether that's a whole life or term. Your dependents will only care about the death benefit and how much that's for. But first, you need to understand some basics. In life and in your personal and financial world, there are temporary goals, and then there are permanent ones. Understand what these are and half your battle's done when it comes to planning and purchasing your insurance products. In fact, the very best advice that I've ever heard on how to determine if any type of insurance is worth exploring further to see if it meets these criteria. Number one, the event should be quite likely to occur. And number two, if the event did happen, it should have a large enough financial impact that you would want someone else, for example, in this case, an insurance company, and not you, to pay the bill. Now, this doesn't mean that you should purchase every type of insurance that passes this criteria, but it seems to me a pretty good test to see what type of coverage you should explore further. Again, everything in life carries risk, and we have to come to terms with, are we going to avoid it? Are we going to assume it, or are we going to transfer that risk? You know, in today's economy, protection is even more important than ever. In the early 2000s and again in 2007 and 8, many people learned what it feels like to lose 20-30% or more of their investment portfolio from market downturns. But imagine this. Imagine losing as much as 80% due to illness or death. The future is uncertain. And the economy unsure, and even the government and company plans don't cover everything. To many people, savings begin and ends with their investment portfolios. They rarely think of insurance, but they should, because even the best laid plans can be derailed by unexpected events. For example, what would happen to you and your family if your spouse became ill or had an accident or even died? Any one of these can reduce your income and increase your expenses, so that you might have to dip into your savings sooner than you had planned. And you might need to even spend it all before you reach retirement. So with insurance, its job is to serve and protect. You see, insurance, in my humble estimation, act like firemen and our policemen. And how is that? Well, insurance products serve and protect our needs and assets, and in fact can help us in growing our assets. With life insurance, personal life insurance is invaluable. It This covers off unexpected costs so that your investments are left intact to grow. Or if you or your spouse should die, life insurance can cover the cost of the lost income of a spouse as well as estate debts and taxes. With critical illness insurance, this pays money as a tax-free lump sum and, of course, can be used for anything that you want it to be used for. Mortgage payments, extra medical expenses, that kind of thing. With disability insurance, this covers off the lost income that would be due to a injury. So you think of savings and insurance as offense and defense. When it comes to good wealth management, having a plan in place is very important. And you need these two things: to grow your investments and to keep those investments safe until you are ready to use them. And that takes both investments and insurance. Neither can do the job alone, but together. They're a team. Investments such as stocks, bonds, term deposits, and registered portfolios would be your offensive players and push your nest egg toward your retirement goals. Insurance policies, which are your defensive players, protect it from being intercepted along the way. And safety, in my mind, is worth the sacrifice, a small sacrifice in contributions, because you only have so much disposable income or cash flow to put away, and there's no question that buying life insurance does add up to a few dollars every month, which means less for investing. However, on the other hand, by not buying insurance, may leave your total investments and estate exposed to undue risk. As always, the best approach is diversification. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. And just by spreading assets across several types of investments can minimize the risk of loss from market instability and volatility. Allocating some of your savings to insurance premiums can minimize the loss of risk from illness or death. Now, depending on your age and income, a sensible proportion might be 70 to 90% savings and 10 to 30% for insurance coverage. Now, the good news is this, is that the younger you are today, the lower your insurance premiums will be, because, of course, they are based on age and health. The more, of course, then, will be left over for investment purposes. And as your income increases over time, the proportion required for insurance can and should be adjusted. I always like to say if insurance was free, we'd all have as much as we wanted and could handle. But because it's not free, then it becomes a matter of negotiating the investment point for the amount that we need. As a person who wants to succeed and prosper, you do, I believe, have an obligation to yourself and your family to consider the risks of your wealth and have a proper insurance products and strategies program in place that can protect you. Now, the need for insurance can be divided into two categories. If I die and when I die. If I die, life insurance refers to having protection for a specified period of time. For example, if I die, life insurance is insuring the family income earners so that there will be sufficient resources to raise children in the event that one or both parents pass on. Once the children are raised, the need for this insurance coverage is greatly reduced or perhaps in fact ends. Because if I die, insurance is needed for a relatively short time, term insurance or low cash value permanent life insurance would work just fine. Now, when I die, life insurance is intended to remain in force until you or the insured dies. For example, when I die, life insurance would be where the insured receives a pension that stops upon his or her death. Life insurance can provide the insured spouse with the equivalent of the missing payments in the event that the spouse survives the pensioner. And as an asset planning tool, when I die, life insurance is permanent. So this permanent insurance can be whole life, universal life, or variable life insurance. For many individuals, term insurance is usually able to cover off the risk of a short-term risk, such as mortgages and the children growing up, as I mentioned earlier, etc. It's relatively inexpensive, especially for young families on a budget. Term is often the only product that they can afford for the coverage amount that they need that would provide them with the amount of coverage that would be appropriate. However, term insurance isn't the total solution, especially later on in life. Perhaps the best way to decide when permanent life is the better choice is simply to know when term insurance makes sense. For most consumers, term insurance will be the appropriate purchase only if for the period that the life insurance is needed is finite. Since term insurance is by definition finite, it ends typically at age 80 or 85. There is some term insurance called term 100, which of course by its name designation means it goes to age 100. But for these type of insurance products, there are no savings that build up within the policy or estate planning objectives associated with the purchase. Now, perhaps the consumer cannot simply afford the amount of life insurance coverage needed except by purchasing the relatively inexpensive term insurance. But again, as a general rule, most term renewable ends at age 80 or 85, which is often well before you as the policy holder would die. And so, of course, while there's a risk that a 28-year-old father of two might be willing to assume he needs lots of coverage and he needs it right now, just in case he does die young, it's not palatable for some of these insurance buyers with longer-term needs. For example, let's look at this. Funeral costs. Now, today, the costs of a simple funeral run about $10,000. And that is often the reason that individuals come to me looking for $15,000 to $20,000 or more as a minimum of permanent insurance later on in life, so that on their death, there would be some cash funds that would be available to pay for their funeral costs and not have to burden your family with them. Now, the other reason for permanent insurance is for estate planning. Of course, it is true that death and taxes are the only certainties in life. It's the reality in which we face. It's true that they are maddeningly and tightly linked and destined, in my estimation, to remain that way for this foreseeable future. Taxes, of course, continue to take a large chunk out of estates, and that can often range between 13 and as much as 48%. And paying these huge levies can be a tremendous burden on heirs that survive, who in some cases are forced to sell off the parents' beloved personal properties, vacation homes which they've enjoyed as children, or perhaps a family business just to settle up accounts with Revenue Canada. Life insurance is a way that provides a way out because the death proceeds of any life insurance policy are, of course, free of income taxes, and a policy can provide the family members with the wherewithal to pay estate taxes and still retain family assets. Of course, all of this works only if there is a life insurance policy that is in effect at the time of the insured's death. And permanent insurance then, of course, is not just preferred, but it's required, since term insurance, again, rarely goes past age 80 or 85, depending on the type of term insurance that you purchase. So, as you know and as we've agreed, life is risky and challenging enough, but getting insurance doesn't have to be. I am always available to review your current situation with you and provide non-biased information and education to guide you in making a decision that makes sense for you and your family. Why? Well, because while the internet gives information, it does not give experience. I have over 28 years of experience in the financial services industry, and as a certified financial planner, investments, and insurance broker, I deliver on the three things that will always be in short supply: time, wisdom, and trust. So get my experience working for you today to create the peace of mind and the proper insurance product that will give you a worry-free financial life. I specialize in working with busy people like you and certainly welcome the opportunity to be of service in your insurance research. To contact me, just click on the appropriate link or tab here. Reach out to me to learn more and connect with us. I look forward to speaking with you soon about whatever is on your mind. And in the meantime, all the very best of success. Take care. Mark Huber, over and out.